In 1876, in the town of Lincoln, Illinois, a daring and ambitious plan for one of the strangest heists in American history was taking shape. A notorious counterfeiting gang from Chicago, led by career criminal James Big Jim Kennelly, found themselves down on their luck. Their go-to engraver slash forger, Benjamin Boyd, was serving a 10-year stretch in Joliet Prison, and their stockpile of counterfeit money was quickly drying up. If their fortunes didn't change soon, they'd be in quite dire straits. It was in these bleak circumstances that Big Jim suddenly came up with an idea that would put his name in the history books in one of the worst ways possible. This was the scheme he had in mind: to steal the body of a prominent citizen from the Oak Ridge Cemetery in Springfield, Illinois, and hold it for ransom. The price for getting the body back in one piece would be a full pardon for Benjamin Boyd and over $200,000 in gold, the equivalent of over $4 million in today's money. So who in the hell was this deceased VIP that Big Jim and company believed would net them their extremely high dollar demands? Well, the corpse in question was that of someone you've probably have heard of. President Abraham Lincoln. That's right, folks. These ye olde Ocean's 11 wannabes were plotting to steal the body of America's 16th president and use it to extort the United States government. Now here's the rundown of their dastardly plan. Phase 1, open up a saloon in the town of Springfield itself so it could act as their forward operations base. This objective was accomplished by June of that year. Their new saloon slash lair was up and running in Springfield's crime-ridden Levee district, where they could work with minimal risk of discovery. Phase 2, get as much intel on the Oak Ridge Cemetery and President Lincoln's tomb as they possibly could. Now, the close proximity of the saloon to the cemetery meant that the criminals could visit and recon the graveyard on a regular basis to figure out the layout of the property without anyone getting suspicious. They discovered that President Lincoln's coffin was encased inside a marble sarcophagus behind an iron gate secured with a padlock. They also learned from the cemetery's caretaker, John C. Power, that the tomb was often left unguarded at night, meaning that there would likely be no trouble in regards to their exit strategy. Now, phase 3 was to figure out the actual heist itself. The plan would be to sneak into the cemetery after dark, cut the padlock off the gate with a saw, open the marble sarcophagus with hammers and chisels, lift the coffin out of the sarcophagus and onto a waiting wagon. From there, the coffin would be transported 2 miles outside of town and buried under a bridge over the Sangamon River, where it would remain until the ransom was paid out. All that was left to do was select a night to pull off the heist, which is where Big Jim demonstrated some pretty surprising mastermind-level genius. He selected the night of July 3rd, the night before Independence Day. An important holiday following on the next morning would guarantee a very public discovery of the theft, which in turn would create public outcry, which in turn would put pressure on the men in power, which in Big Jim's mind would mean that they would be more likely to give in to his demands. So the stage was set for one of the grisliest and most audacious crimes ever to be committed in American history. And then it went all wrong. Prior to the day of the intended heist, one of the crew members got drunk one night and procured the services of a local prostitute, to whom he told the entire plan in great detail. The prostitute in turn told the story to several other people she was acquainted with, including Springfield Police Chief Abner Wilkinson. Soon word got out and the crew boss, Thomas Sharp, was forced to scrap the whole plan and walk away. Now, Big Jim was able to avoid any heat from the botched heist, but he wasn't prepared to throw in the towel just yet and got back to work. He decided to start over from square one and set up shop in a Chicago saloon called The Hub. From there, he put together a brand new crew of two men named Terrence Mullen and Jack Hughes, who were considerably much more reliable, except they weren't too keen on the whole grave robbing thing, which prompted them to seek out something of an expert. That expert being a man named Jim Morrissey, aka a professional grave robber. Morrissey liked the plan and thought it could be done, but he insisted that they bring in another pair of hands to ensure that it could be pulled off successfully. Mullen and Hughes agreed, and so Morrissey brought in a friend of his named Billy Brown to drive the wagon needed to transport President Lincoln's casket. The plan for the heist was pretty much the same as it was before. The only real difference was instead of hiding the coffin under the Sangamon River Bridge, they'd take it further away and bury it in the Indiana sand dunes until the ransom was paid. The new date for the heist would be the night of November 7th, election night, when the area surrounding the cemetery would be abandoned due to folks staying close to the saloons and precincts to await the results of the election when the polls closed. November 7th was soon upon them, and the crew quickly sprung into action. When night fell, they descended on Oak Ridge Cemetery with their wagon and tools. The heist was on. The crew successfully snuck into the cemetery and up to the Lincoln tomb without being detected. But a minor hiccup soon arose when the saw that they were using to cut the padlock off the iron gate broke, meaning they had to switch to a file in order to finish the job. Soon the padlock was off, the iron gate was open, and the thieves were now inside the tomb. With their hammers and chisels, the crew began working away the heavy lid of the marble sarcophagus. Soon the crew were able to slide off the heavy lid, and the coffin was visible under the dim light of their lanterns. Eager to get a move on, Mullen and Hughes sent Morrissey outside to signal Brown to bring up the wagon. Morrissey did as he was instructed as the two men set to work removing the coffin from the breached sarcophagus. They managed to move the coffin onto the floor of the tomb and decided to head outside to get some air while Morrissey was fetching the wagon. Then all of a sudden, gunshots rang out. The frightened Mullen and Hughes didn't know what to do. Morrissey had not returned, nor were they positive if he was alive, or if Brown was even still waiting with the wagon. So they decided to leave the coffin along with the tools and run for it. Mullen and Hughes eventually made it back to Chicago, returned to their hideout at the hub, and what did they find waiting for them? Morrissey, alive and well. The stunned thieves were relieved to see their compatriot, but wondered what had happened with the shots being fired. Morrissey didn't seem to know what they were talking about, claiming that he had brought the horses and wagon back to the tomb. But Mullen and Hughes had already skedaddled, and since there was no way that Morrissey and Brown were going to lift a 500-pound coffin by themselves, he decided to get out of there and go back to Chicago where it was safe. So it was that the crew decided to spend that evening getting plastered and celebrating their narrow escape. But their relief would be short-lived. On November 18th, the crew was tracked down and arrested by one Captain Patrick Tyrell of the United States Secret Service, the very same man who had put Benjamin Boyd in prison for forgery, coincidentally enough. After their arrest, Mullen and Hughes learned that Tyrell had been onto them from the very beginning and knew the details of their plan backwards and forwards. How did Tyrell come by his information? Well, that would be thanks to the testimonies of Morrissey and Brown, otherwise known as Agents Louis Swiegels and Bill Neely of the Secret Service. Apparently, the Secret Service still remembered the botched heist back in July and somehow got wind of another attempt by the same crew who were looking for manpower. So Tyrell put Swiegels undercover with the crew to get intel. From the information Swiegels was able to relate back to him, Tyrell managed to put together a small army of hired guns from the Pinkerton Detective Agency and followed the crew all the way from Chicago to Springfield. Now, you may be wondering what the hell was the deal with the mysterious gunshots being fired on the night of the heist. Well, what had happened was Swiegels had left the tomb ostensibly for the purposes of bringing up the wagon and horses so that they could load up the coffin like Mullen and Hughes requested. But in reality, Swiegels had gone around to the front of the tomb and signaled Tyrell and the Pinkertons, who were patiently waiting in the shadows of the graveyard. You see, Tyrell's plan was to catch the thieves in the act of stealing President Lincoln's coffin, and when Swiegels gave the signal, he and the Pinkertons moved in. Tyrell and company reached the tomb and discovered the president's coffin on the floor along with the tools, but there was no sign of Mullen and Hughes. You see, unknown to both the undercover agents and Tyrell, Mullen and Hughes had stepped out for some air for a moment and somehow managed to narrowly avoid being spotted by the detectives. And then chaos ensued for the next several moments. Tyrell and the Pinkertons scattered across the graveyard looking for Mullen and Hughes, and when they thought they had spotted them attempting to flee, they fired at them. However, it turned out that the men that they were firing at were actually Swiegels and Neely, who were attempting to get clear. Thankfully, neither man was hurt, but the damage had already been done. Thanks to the confusion, Mullen and Hughes managed to get away, although they were still completely unaware that the entire incident was a trap to ensnare them. Eventually, Mullen and Hughes were put on trial in Springfield, and by that point, the whole country had learned of the attempted theft of President Lincoln's body. While the greater United States was outraged, the people of Springfield in particular were hungry for swift and terrible justice to be brought down upon the heads of Mullen and Hughes. However, Illinois state law quickly dashed those hopes. While grave robbing was and is indeed still quite despicable, at that time in Illinois, it was a minor offense, which meant that the maximum penalty that could be enforced was 1 year in prison, which was what Mullen and Hughes each received for their role in the heist. Sometime later, Big Jim was arrested and given the same sentence. All three were sent to do their time in Joliet, right alongside forger Benjamin Boyd, whom they were attempting to free with their dastardly caper in the first place. While Big Jim, Mullen, and Hughes' punishments may have been light, the whole sordid affair inspired the Illinois legislature to amend the law. From here on out, the minimum sentence for grave robbing would be elevated from 1 year in prison to 10 years in prison. As for the body of President Lincoln, it was reinterred within the marble sarcophagus, the iron gate was reinforced, and a semi-permanent honor guard was ordered to dissuade any further heist attempts. Eventually, a new and improved tomb would be built, and President Lincoln's coffin would be reburied in a steel cage 10 feet underground and covered with concrete, guaranteeing that his final rest would never again be disturbed. So there you have it, probably the most noteworthy instance of attempted grand larceny, extortion, and desecration of a corpse in the history of the United States. I guess if there's any pearls of wisdom to be found here, it'd be how crime doesn't pay, karma's a bitch, and Lady Justice always takes what she's owed with interest. If you like this video, please show your support by hitting the like button and sharing it with your friends. If you're curious about my future content and want to hear more extraordinary tales, then please subscribe to my channel and hit the little bell icon so you'll be notified when new content is uploaded. Until next time, have a lovely day, stay safe out there, and most importantly, look for the extraordinary!